you like this format? Is it fun for the players?
Yeah, unbelievably fun. You know, I've watched a lot of All-Star games in the past. This is my first time to, you know, actually be a participant. But, you know, I watched it last year, and it looked like the guys were having a blast. And, you know, hopefully I can have a blast this year as well. You know, I think just the calmness of the guys that are actually here. You know, everyone here is like, everyone acts like they've been here before. So it's, you know, it's pretty eye opening. But it's, you know, at the same time, it's, you know, it's an honor to be here. Yeah, you know, I think it, you know, it took a little bit, but you know, Philadelphia is such a great organization, and you know, as soon as I got there, I felt welcome with open arms. You know, I think the town of Philadelphia, you know, they're just blue collar, hardworking people, and you know, that's kind of what I base my game around. So, you know, I was accepted pretty quickly, and you know, I definitely appreciate the people of Philly.
Because there's a movie about your life. Who are you picking to play you?
Denzel Washington, 100%.
Why Denzel?
It's all right. Denzel can fit any mold, right? He's, you know, to me, I think he's probably one of the best actors of all time. You know, an actor that I've always watched, and you know, I'd be honored if, you know, Denzel would try and play me.
Who would your teammates pick to play you if you?
To be honest with you, I got no clue. Probably someone that's probably pretty mean or something like that. But I'm a softie at heart, so.
Do you have a favorite hockey movie? Is there one that stands out above the rest?
Probably Mighty Ducks. I think growing up, every Sunday, it used to come on TBS. When I was little, I remember I'd be sitting there with my mom. She'd be folding laundry, and I'd be watching Mighty Ducks all day long, Mighty Ducks 1, 2, and 3. So that's probably the movie that, you know, that inspires me the most.
Who was your favorite in the movie?
I liked Russ Tyler, Fulton Reed, you know, the tough guys. Those are the thing I got off on. So it was great.
Bobby Clark's NHL dreams began in Flin Flon, Manitoba, where he grew up and played junior hockey.
In Flin Flon, you were so far away from the NHL that you dreamed of playing there, but you weren't close enough to ever have any idea what it was about.
Though he was possibly the best player available in the 1969 draft, Clark dropped because of concerns over his health.
I think it was because of diabetes.
Everybody worried whether he was going to be able to have the stamina to play in the NHL.
To think that some teams actually passed on him twice in the draft that year. The Flyers got him actually in the second round.
Clark adjusted his diet, and diabetes didn't prevent him from becoming a star in Philadelphia.
Bobby Clark led all scoring with 63 points in his second campaign.
At just 23 years old, Clark was named captain of the Flyers and led by example with his work ethic.
The old equalizer is hard work. Some guys have a lot of ability, but you know, they don't work as hard. And the guys with lesser ability work harder. You know, I think that's the equalizer.
It was almost like his work ethic embarrassed everybody else on the team to work hard like him. And that's leadership.
You got to work and produce if you want your teammates to do the same. You can't demand of others what you don't do yourself.
They created something special in Philadelphia, and Clark was the ringleader in so many ways.
He was our inspirational leader on the ice, rolls off the ice. You know, the saying goes, as Clark goes, the Flyers go.
Clark proved to be the perfect captain for a team that was dubbed the Broad Street Bullies.
I loved it. I mean, in a physical sport, if you're the most physical, that's a big advantage.
We did have a rugged side to us, and we had finesse and good hockey players. You don't win through bullying.
But that toughness helped Philly get a reputation as a win-at-all-cost team that followed Clark's lead.
Clark, he never quit on any play. The team rallied around that. He always came up big with plays. He would do anything to win.
That was the message that every guy in the National Hockey League knew. Watch out for Clark. He'll do anything to win.
In the 1973-74 season, it all came together for Clark and the Flyers. As they won the franchise's first Stanley Cup.
I said lots of times, that's as close to heaven as I'll ever get. Winning out the first time is really, really special.
Clark and the Flyers would win the Stanley Cup again the following year, and Philadelphia would have an incredible run of dominance, highlighted by Clark winning the Hart Trophy 3 out of 4 years.
Bob Clark is a competitor, the best I've ever seen.
Clark was inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame in 1987 and is still considered the face of the franchise because of his success as a player and team executive for the Flyers.
There are no Flyers Stanley Cups without Bob Clark.
He turned out to be one of the greatest players in the history of the game and one of the all-time leaders in all of sports.
I've seen a lot of leaders in the National Hockey League, and Clark is one of the top leaders.
Is for the magnificent performance by Bernie Perron, the premier goaltender of the NHL.
Montreal native Bernie Perron grew up watching the Canadiens and idolizing their goaltender.
My idol was Pierre Blanc. I loved him. His sister lived next door to us, so he used to come in once a year during the summer. I forget this. He would get out of his big car. He had a hat on, big cigar. He'd walk around. I watched him. I was too scared to shake hands with him.
Perron eventually got the chance to meet and learn from his childhood hero when they became teammates in 1971.
He was a goalie in Toronto. He was 43 years old at the time. It was incredible. I would watch him during the games. And finally, I asked him, I said, can you teach me? Bingo, he said, sure. So that changed my whole career.
Jock was a very good angle goaltender. So he used to bring these strings and ropes out in the ice, and he had proved to Bernie, if you play in this position, you'll blip this shot. Or play that position, you'll be in control of the shots when they come to you.
A year later, Perron moved on from the Leafs, taking with him the lessons learned from Plante.
What I learned from him was the understanding of the game.
Perron is a landmark figure for the Philadelphia Flyers. They had selected him from Boston in the 1967 expansion draft, and he was their top goaltender for 3.5 years before being traded to Toronto. But in 1973, he returned to Philadelphia, continuing his success in the net while beginning to forge his place in hockey history.
He's a stand-up goaltender, never went down. He always steered the pucks to the corners. You know, if there was a shot in net, you know where it had to go to retrieve it to get control of the puck again.
Some great goaltending by Bernie Perron.
Classic skate save.
Played his angle extremely well. Very, very seldom you cut Bernie down, and that's why he was tough to score on.
In 73-74, Perron began one of the most historic goaltending runs in hockey history, winning a record 47 games, a mark that would stand for 33 years.
Well, I think like every player, when you get to the playoffs, your game rises, and his did.
Perron led the Flyers to the franchise's first Stanley Cup final, and they faced off against the Boston Bruins.
I think Boston took us a little bit lightly, because we were an expansion team, only 7 years in existence.
We would never won the first cup wasn't for Bernie, because 3 minutes to go in the game and Ken Hodge comes down, lets the shot go, and I'm on the bench, sitting on the bench, I could see the shot angling, it's going for the wide far post, and Bernie just happened to stick his toe out there just as it was going in the net, and I think we all knew that we were going to win the cup there.
Perron capped off his historic season by bringing home the Vezina Trophy. All of this success was only fuel for him to burn the following season as the Flyers played their way right back to the Stanley Cup Final.
It's all over! The Flyers have won the second in a row! The Flyers have won their second consecutive Stanley Cup!
Well, I think he actually played better in the second series against Buffalo in the finals. We had taken a lot of penalties, and Buffalo had some players that could really shoot the puck. They had the great Gilbert Perreault. They had the French connection there. Bernie was on his game then, and that he was really instrumental in that second cup.
The most valuable player in the playoffs, Bernie Perron, wins it the second year in a row.
Now, the second year we won in Buffalo, we got on the plane, a charter back to Philly. We put the Stanley Cup in the middle of the aisle. The whole plane got quiet. All we did for a half hour, look at this beautiful trophy. It was so beautiful.
Perron once again won the Vezina, completing one of the most commanding stretches ever for a goaltender. In 1979, Perron suffered an eye injury that cut his career short. But his historic era for the Broad Street Bullies will live long in memory.
For 5 or 6 years there, he was the best in the game. That's pretty good.
You have a goal, you have a vision, so whatever you want to do in life. don't quit. You know, there'll be times where it's going to be dark, but you keep pushing, and eventually you get the rewards. Beautiful thing.
A childhood prodigy. I remember growing up in Toronto and hearing a lot about Eric Lindros.
Everyone had the expectation that he was going to be the next great one.
The Quebec Nordiques are very proud to select as first pick overall in the 1991 NHL draft, Eric Lindros.
The big question now, of course, though, is will he sign with the Quebec Nordiques?
Quebec held his rights for one full year, then still unable to sign him, dealt Lindros to Philadelphia in a blockbuster trade.
We wouldn't be giving up as much as we have if we didn't feel that Eric Lindros was worth a substantial contract.
We didn't see guys that size with that talent.
He was that new physical power forward that happened to have really good hands.
Eric was one of the only guys, 6'4 and bigger, that can move and do the things that he did.
A much more physical game than it is today. And that's what you have to do to get through to get to the puck, get on the forecheck. Everything went big.
Lindros moves in, score!
He was a horse. I'm not sure there's ever been a player quite like Eric.
He'd run you right over. He was taking the puck to the net. He could do it all.
There's a 19-year-old showing you the ability that he has and what his future is all about.
It's better playing on his team than against him, I can tell you that.
Lindros scored 41 goals in his rookie season despite missing almost 20 games with a knee injury. And in 1995, he won the Hart Trophy as league MVP and the Lester Pearson Award. But the passionate power forward had bigger aspirations.
Thank you to the fans of Philadelphia who supported us when we weren't so good. We're getting better, and we're going to do it. There was lots that I was putting on myself to go and try to achieve. Our team wasn't real deep. With a couple of moves, you could see the makings of a real quality team.
A trade with Montreal would bring John LeClair to Philadelphia, where he teamed with Lindros and Michael Renberg to create one of the scariest lines in hockey.
Legion of Doom with LeClair and Renberg, you know, they were so tough to play against.
There's a lot of meat on that line, and it was just a battle.
His line was miserable to play against. They were making it completely difficult on me as a defenseman.
Once we got things rolling, it just seemed to click.
He scores! Oh, the Legion of Doom is weaving their magic tonight!
Lindros and the Legion of Doom helped the Flyers capture an Eastern Conference championship in 1997. They faced Detroit in the Cup final, but came up short. In 8 years with the Flyers, Eric Lindros scored at least 30 goals 6 times and became the fifth fastest player to 500 points. But injuries, including concussions, began to take their toll. Lindros finished his career with the Rangers, Leafs, and Stars and retired in 2007.
For 5 years, no one dominated the game like Lindros. But unfortunately, because of injury and the way he played the game, his career was cut short.
He sustained probably more major hits than any other player in history and still battled through them, went on to have a well-deserved Hall of Fame career.
It's humbling to stand here today, who accept a place in the Hockey Hall of Fame. Since the time I started playing pro hockey until today, my life is as good as it's ever been. When you're having fun, you're playing well. And I certainly had a lot of great times and a lot of smiles.
Oh, you know, I actually, you know, I do that probably before every game on pregame skate. So, you know, Joey Mullins feeding me pucks from there, one-timers, and I had a little bit more room, so I'm used to that shot.
How about the other things? You know, the fastest skater I know was a little bit of a surprise, but overall, it was a good day.
Well, I don't think I'm the fastest skater or the most graceful, but you know, it was a lot of fun. You know, Trocheck crushed me there. I think he beat me by a whole line, but. You know, I tried, but, you know, didn't work out the greatest, but it was, you know, still a great experience.
What's the atmosphere in general like over there on the bench when you guys are watching the whole thing? I'm sure there's a little bit of talk and stuff like that.
Yeah, guys are just messing around, you know, horsing around, you know, it's pretty fun. You know, I was actually mic'd up, so hopefully I got some pretty good stuff, and, you know, it's, you know, everyone's just enjoying it, you know, everything's just the time, you know, to, you know, reflect on, you know, some of the year and, you know, just have fun with the guys.
about the experience of being in front of these fans again? Obviously, they remember you.
Yeah, you know, I got a pretty good ovation, so you know, it's pretty surprised, but it was, you know, it was good. You know, I felt welcome back.
How about tomorrow? What do you what have you picked up on about what that tournament's like, either from guys that played last year or what you saw?
You know, just try to possess the puck, I guess. You know, I know from you know, playing 3-on-3, obviously with the Flyers, that you know, you rather have the puck than not have the puck in the 3-on-3. You know, just make sure. You know, for me, we got a pretty good team, so I'll probably just dish the puck and try to get open for some shots.